Hi, everyone. We're going to be talking a little bit about PyTorch today with Sunita. She's here in San Francisco at the PyTorch Conference 2024. Sunita, can you tell us, just as a start, what is PyTorch?
Yeah, PyTorch is an open source framework for deep learning and is used for building and deploying machine learning models. PyTorch is great with maintaining the balance between the flexibility and the performance. So the flexibility being very important for ML researchers and scientists because they always want the simple API and their focus is on developing the model and adding the accuracy. And performance is very much important for deploying into production. So that is where the PyTorch gives the right balance and right tools for everyone.
Yeah, awesome. Now, your specific role in the project, because I believe you're part of the open source project itself and contributing to it. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. We are the PyTorch maintainers for ARM64 Linux CPUs. So as part of that, actually, we started with our own processors, that is AWS Graviton, which are based on ARM64. And we started it pretty much from scratch. So we had to optimize the framework from end to end and then bring those optimizations back to the community, to the developers, and also to scale to our customers. And then finally, we had to add infrastructure to able to maintain those features release over release. So to give you a very high-level view of what those optimizations are, we picked a handful of models from computer vision, NLP, and recommender systems. And then we accelerated each of them with the most performant gem kernels. And we added a lot of runtime tunables, whether it is formats like bfloat16 or runtime allocations with THP. And then we also added a lot of collateral around that, like user guides and best practices guides, so that customers can bring it up on their own. We also added nightly wheels and release binaries with all those optimizations enabled. So it is readily available in the Python wheels or deep learning containers for them to use, for you to start using them.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, that's definitely something I still want to dig to in a future conversation with you, is about how the build system works, because I took a look and my background is in DevOps and it looks like a lot of fun and interesting things there. Mm-hmm. But tell us a little bit more about why ARM64, because obviously we've got a bunch of different architectures mm-hmm. that we use. Why is ARM64 important?
Yeah, that's a great question. Actually, ARM64 has got a lot of features that are, to support ML inference, especially ML inference. So to name a few, when we've designed our AWS Graviton 3, we put conscious effort to bring all of them. To name a few, it has got, along with Neon Engine, it has got an SVE. SVE is a scalable vector extensions. That engine lets the developers to vectorize more and more code, and it provides flexibility with what code can be vectorized. And it also adds bfloat16 format, which can deliver up to 2x better performance compared to FP32, and without any dropping in the accuracy. Mm. That is the right balance for the inference workloads again. And it has also got twice the SIMD bandwidth compared to its previous generation Graviton. So combining all these, the ARM64s and the CPUs are very much suitable and apt for AI ML inference. In fact, they are also providing the cost effective option on AWS for CPU-based AI ML inference.
So your contributions on the project is specifically around the performance tuning of that, and there's a component of that that goes into the framework as well as that you can configure at runtime. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure, yeah, most of the optimizations are automatically detected and enabled without any control needed. However, there are a few features which can be tuned on top of the default ones to get better performance. One of them being the bfloat16. While the default configuration is FP32, one can just enable with DNNL runtime flag and get up to 2x better throughput. Oh, wow. Without a significant drop in the accuracy. That provides the right balance for inference kind of workloads. And another such tunable is the THP, that is the transparent huge page allocations, which again are a great way of reducing the runtime overhead for inference, and that can give up to 10 to 15% improvement.
Oh, wow. So can you show us how to do this runtime performance tuning?
Yes, I do have a demo where we can go more in detail and where you can get more, how you can reproduce on your own. I'm going to cover all those.
Awesome, let's take a look.
To show you how you can take advantage of runtime tuning, so let me walk you through a sample network. Here is the network that I'm going to run today. As you can see here, it has got a simple linear layer followed by ReLU, which is a typical architecture for transformers-based models. And here for the weights, I'm using large numbers just to match close enough to the LLMs. And for the input, I'm using 256 batch size, just to show you how you can how these optimizations make difference for the large batch scenarios. And for the output, I'm running around 50 iterations just to get the stable run. And finally, I'm printing the output from Torch Profiler. So I've got the PyTorch 2.4 installed without any runtime tunings. I'm going to show you how the default performance is. Okay. So here we are using the CPU device. That is our AWS Graviton processor, Graviton 3 based C7G instance. Here is the output, which is around 10 seconds for the 50 iterations of LLM inference. And now let me show you how you can accelerate with the BFloat 16 compute. So for that, you need to set fast math mode for DNN, that is DNNL default FP math mode to BF16. So with that, I'm going to rerun the same network. Yeah, as you see here, the 10 seconds drop down to 3.9 seconds, which is more than 2x improvement for LLM inference in this case. Since these are like large tensors, here you can even take advantage of Linux transparent huge pages, which save a lot of runtime for the table walkthrough. So for that, all you need to do is just enable THP memalloc enable set to 1. I'm going to rerun the same network. So with this, the latencies are dropped from 4 to 3.5 seconds, which is another 10% improvement. So overall, with these two runtime tunings, we are able to get more than 2x improvement compared to the default configuration. And all these optimizations are readily available in any PyTorch version, starting PyTorch 2.x. So you are free to give them a try and get just uplift the performance for your workloads. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Anita, for that demo. Are there any resources or things you want to share with the folks before they finish off watching this video?
Yeah, we have user guides and tuning guides and all the release and nightly wheels. All those details are given in the description.
Awesome. Thanks very much, Sunita. I learned a lot. And if you enjoyed this kind of content, please like this video and subscribe to the channel. We are releasing a lot more hands-on videos for developers that want to learn more. Awesome.
Or take one.
You should have said armed and ready. And then I've got one final interview question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know why Python lives on land?
What Python lives on land?
Yes, it's above sea level. Yeah.